You may have a seat for just a minute. I want to welcome you this morning to Gulfview. Thanks for coming to worship with us today. Hopefully you got a worship guide when you came in. It does a couple things for you. It kind of gives you what we call a what to expect, that kind of outlines what we're going to be talking about today during the message. And on the back, it's got a bunch of different announcements and things for you. First, I want to draw your attention, if you could. If you're new to us, we want to say welcome to you. So glad that you're able to be here with us. If you're able to, there's kind of these connect cards, these little blue cards in the seat back in front of you. If you could fill one of those out and just turn it into the Welcome Center on your way out. It's kind of our first way to get to know a little bit about who you are and begin to get to be acquainted with you. And then on the back of your worship guide, we have a couple different events and things happening. One that's not on there is our Anticipating Easter series. We're going through the Gospels as we get ready for Easter. We started this back on January 1, and then the Saturday before Easter ends, we'll have read through all four of the Gospels. We were off for 2 weeks because we had our business meeting, and then Pastor Paul and I were away in Melbourne last week, so we'll be starting that back up this week. That's Wednesday nights at 7 o'clock right here. We'll be looking at the Gospel of John starting this week. If you haven't journeyed with us and if you want to hop in, now's a great time to do that because we're starting a new book. You can scan that QR code to get the reading plan, or you can go to gulfviewgrace.org and scroll down there and you'll see a link for that reading plan there. So we'd love to have you come out and meet with us Wednesday night from 7 to 8 o'clock. And then a couple other things related to Easter. We have our family Easter egg hunt. This is March 23rd from 10 to 12:30. On the welcome booth in the back there, there's some of these little flyers that you can grab. These are a great way to invite a family member or a neighbor or someone that you meet to this event at the church. We're going to have a couple different things we're working on, still hopefully getting some inflatables and stuff. If you are able to, we need some donations of eggs and individually wrapped candy, preferably not chocolate because it does get hot in Florida, and we don't want to serve them hot fudge when they get their eggs. And so if you could get some of those, there's a box at the Welcome Center that you can drop those in. That would be greatly appreciated, and we'll have a sign-up sheet at the back at the end of the service if you want to help with either stuffing those eggs, helping to run that event. Maybe you're good at popping popcorn, you want to help with that, or help with some of the kids and stuff for that. That would be great. We really could use your help with that. Again, that's coming up on March 23rd at 10 a.m. Second thing is we have our threefold communion service. That's March 29th at 6:30 p.m. This is a great thing that we get to do each year. On Friday, we get to look at the passion of Jesus, and the way we celebrate communion here is kind of a threefold. We do a meal together, we do foot washing, and then we'll take the bread and the cup together, representing Christ's past, present, and future ministry to us, our justification, our sanctification, and glorification. This is a great opportunity for that. There's a sign up on the bottom of your worship guide. If you would like to attend that, we'd love to know that you're coming just so we can make sure to plan for the right number of people. You can just kind of rip that off there and turn that into the Welcome Center so we can begin to get a count for that. Again, that's March 29th. That's the Friday before Easter. And you can see some more details there. And then lastly is Easter Sunday. This is going to be March 31st, just a couple weeks away. We're already almost at Easter. Another thing that's at the Welcome Center is these little Easter invite cards. Again, another great way for you to invite friends or family to that. On the back of that's all the details. Just note that we only have kids during the second service, so if you're inviting somebody who has kids, you want to direct them to come to that second service, and you want to come with them if you're inviting them to that. But make note of these different things that we have, these ways that you can connect with your community as we get ready for Easter. Now we're going to have Libby Lester is going to come up and read us our scripture reading. We're going to continue our series this morning in 1 Thessalonians. We're going to be in 1 Thessalonians 4, verse 13 through 18. And maybe we could do this. If you could stand with us this morning as we read scripture, that would be great.
Good morning. Thank you. Brothers, we do not want you to be ignorant about those who fall asleep or to grieve like the rest of the men who have no hope. We believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. According to the Lord's own word, we tell you that who are still alive, who are left till the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage each other with these words.
Thank you. fills the streets to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before him. There will be a day when death will be no more. Standing face to face with he who died and rose again. Holy, holy is the Lord. And every prayer prayed in desperation, the songs of faith we sing. Stand beside the heroes of the faith. With one voice, a thousand generations sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And on that day, we join the resurrection and stand beside
morning. This is our time of offertory prayer and worship, and we want to thank mainly our volunteers for all the time and effort they put into making things happen here. So we appreciate our volunteers very much. As you may know, there's three ways you can give to this ministry. There's two black boxes at the back of the worship center here where you can put your offertory. You can also use the Tithe app online, which is a great way. It's very simple to use. And of course, you can mail a check or drop one off at the church office. Would you join me in prayer as we reach for the Lord? Father, we thank you today. We thank you for all that you give us. You're there with us through thick and thin. Lord, you're just so gracious to us. And we praise you, God, now that we can give you this time of our time and offerings, our tithe of our time and offerings for you. May we be cheerful givers and focus on what you do for us. And we praise you and honor you in Jesus' name. Amen.
I want to thank the praise team this morning for working overtime. As you can see, we've used everybody on the stage to do something twice. we're missing some of the team this morning. Some of our team is sick, and so pray for them as they are helping direct their children's mouths to buckets, if you know what I mean by that. And so some of them are doing that, and we're kind of glad they're not here this morning to share their illness with us. And so that's where some of them are. And other parts of our team are actually in kids ministry today helping out. And we're just grateful for the many that we serve. And this should be a reminder to you that we need more people to serve. And so don't let us hog it all, right? You can help us out with that. And we are grateful for the many ways that different ones of you serve in many capacities, from hospitality team to nursery or kids or youth or whatever it is. We are very grateful for you. Well, I was expecting this morning to be like a thin crowd, like everybody either forgot to set their clock back or they just said, we're just going to wait and hit the second service. But you guys are here, and so this is great. So I'm grateful for that. Hopefully your energy will give me energy as I am just exhausted. And I know you are probably as well. And so maybe you need that second cup of coffee. You're going to have to wait now because we're now in the thick of this. So a couple of years ago, my family was just kind of eating out. We were just kind of playing with our phones, and my son Kyron and I were just kind of, I don't know how we got on it, but we just kind of opened up our calendar app on our iPhone, and we were curious to know how far ahead in the future we could go on our calendar app before Siri. You know who Siri is, right? Probably all of our phones are now binking. But before Siri would stop us. And so we were curious how far, how many years, how many hundreds of years or thousands of years could we go until finally the Apple would crash? And so we kept going and going and going, and we couldn't believe it. We were actually in the year 3,300, and it was still allowing us to go through our calendar app, and we never did hit the end. And so as a part of that conversation, we were just kind of having fun, and I actually took a screenshot of this because I thought it was so cool. But my son actually put a calendar date on the year 3,288. He set an appointment reminder for himself, and he just simply said, lunch with the Apostle Paul. Because my son Kyron knew, and it says right there, as of January 1st, 3,288, right, that would be the year, that by then he would either be in heaven, right, or probably somehow walking with the Apostle Paul. And so he knew that he would be in heaven or on the new earth, we could say. And so he kind of made this this kind of date. It's also interesting to see that the food pantry is still working hard. It's on my calendar. So we share calendars. And so the church calendar is still working at the year 3,288. I couldn't believe it. So and my son Keelan, his birthday is actually there. I actually do birthdays on my calendar. And so he's probably over 3,000 years of age at that time as well. And so just kind of interesting how all of that works. And so we never did find the end. Maybe you'll kind of do this over dinner and just keep scrolling through. Who knows? In January of this year, I received kind of a packet in the mail, and it's a packet that's typically junk mail, and I kind of just get all these things and throw them away. And this was just one of those other days, and it was just kind of an investment kind of a piece of paper. It looked kind of like a newspapery kind of paper, and I just kind of took it. I was about to rip it up and throw it away, but something in the heading kind of grabbed my attention, and it simply said, American Funds. That's kind of the name of this investment mutual fund that I'm in, and I kind of say that like I'm in many, and I'm not, just so you know. It just so happens that this one, they were sending me kind of this update on kind of as I'm looking towards the future, and it just said, American Funds 2040, in bold across the top of this small booklet. And again, I just thought it was junk mail, about to throw it out. And then that number 2040 kind of arrested my attention. And you're much sharper than I am, and you probably already know what that 2040 means, but it didn't hit me until I read it all the way through that I was actually reading a piece of paper that was telling me that at 2040, this is my proposed retirement age. And I started to quickly do the math from my birth date on, and I'm thinking, that's like 17 years. And I started to plan my funeral. But I'm like, I can't believe it, that the R word is at some point. Now, who knows? Maybe I'll go longer than that, and hopefully I won't be retiring that. I don't know. Hopefully I have a little more steam left in me when I'm 67 years of age. I don't know. But it just kind of, again, just captured my attention, because probably this year is a big year for me. So I know I'm turning a particular age. I won't mention that age, but I'm turning an age where from then on they say everything moves faster because you go downhill from there. And so I'm glad to be kind of going downhill and kind of moving faster, and so I can't wait for that experience to happen. But what this was is this was a financial summary prospectus. Many of you get these, right, on a regular basis. And it was this document given to investors in order to help inform you on your investment decisions as you're planning for your future. And honestly, just being real with you, it stays within this room, but my heart kind of sank because I was never faced with that. I mean, it was real. It was right there. And I was just like, oh my goodness, one day I'm actually going to retire. And so my future flashed before my eyes. And here's the truth, is that all of us at some point are facing a future, right? Even right now, our toddlers who are in nursery are anticipating a future. Now, their future is much more narrow and simpler than ours. Their future is, I hope mom and dad return to pick me up after nursery because I want to go home today, right? Your future, maybe you're wrestling with some other things. Some of us were wrestling with, you know, the future, and so we tap into stock experts because we want to know kind of where's the best places that we can kind of invest our finances, or maybe we tap into the Weather Channel because we want to know the future of the weather, and should I even go outside today, right? And so we're tapping into these experts to find out what we should do as we're kind of planning ahead for the future. We do this on a regular basis, some of you on a weekly basis. You visit experts called doctors, right? Because you want to know, I want to know, how do I take care of my body as I'm anticipating a future life, and hopefully it's a longer one. And so all of us are looking ahead to the future as we're planning out, at least we're trying to plan out some of the steps of our life. And although human beings can take great pride in our intellectual decision-making abilities, and many times we can say, I've got this all figured out, and I'm investing in the right places, I'm eating healthy, I'm doing all this. But as we learned last week, all of that can stop in a second. So when it comes to knowing the future, every human being must claim ignorance. You just don't know, right? You just don't know. And if you desire to know anything about the future, you and I are going to need help. And today, Jesus is going to give us that help through the Apostle Paul in our series that we've been going through. So God's word provides us with the help that we need. The Bible paints a very vivid picture of the future that it leaves no doubt as to God's ultimate plan for human history. And this includes the fate of every single person who has ever lived. Today we're looking at six short verses that we come to in our Faith, Love, and Hope series, and it's going to begin to give us some of the answers to this future life that all of us are anticipating. And as we begin to study this passage, it's going to start off a little on the discouraging side. We're going to talk about this word called grieving, and Paul's going to kind of hit that out front and kind of help us to get the bad news out of the way. And grieving is a natural part of our life, and that's okay. And so he's going to talk about that grieving aspect, but then towards the end, he's going to bring in some hope. In fact, you're going to find that these six verses are peppered with hope all over it. But he starts again with a little bit on this discouraging side. He's going to talk about grief. He's going to talk about death. He's going to talk about the fact that these Thessalonian Christians who are new believers, remember we've been studying this, that they're actually losing some of their friends. Their friends are passing. And as their friends are passing, they're asking themselves, what's happening to them as they're dying? What is their future? And so they're having some great questions that they're asking, and Paul's writing back to them, kind of telling them, here's some hope that you need to have in Jesus. And I love, we're going to look at the last verse that we're going to study, and it's verse 18 in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, because I want to tell you the good news first. And so Paul ends this little section with these words, therefore encourage one another with these words. The word that Paul uses here in this original language for the word encourage also means to comfort. And so it's kind of this multifaceted word. It means to comfort, but it also means to encourage. And that's the word that he's using here. And so this passage, it's meant to comfort us. This passage, as Paul wrote this letter to the church of Thessalonica, it's meant to encourage them. It's meant to comfort them. He wants them to know that, and he's going to tell them in a second, that this is what's going to happen to your loved ones who've passed away. And let me tell you, he says, I want to encourage you with these words. I want to comfort you with these words. So this passage is meant to encourage us. It's also meant to comfort us and to give us a courageous kind of life as we want to be future-minded. So we've been studying in great detail, verse by verse, this little letter that the Apostle Paul writes, kind of five chapters, and you know this. If you're joining us for the first time, you may not know this, and so hopefully you'll be able to kind of catch up with where you're at, but the Apostle Paul is writing to a very young church that was in the city of Thessalonica. It's Thessalonica, Greece today. You can actually go there and walk there. And this church was planted by the Apostle Paul. And so the Apostle Paul and his missionary team had this love for the people of the church of Thessalonica. And he wanted to help them. He wanted to help them spiritually to grow in their newfound faith. And so he and his traveling team invested in their life. And we learned that in chapter 4 and 5, Paul will begin to now give them the instructional instructional component, right, of these five chapters. And so he starts with the first three, really just encouraging them and telling them, I'm so proud of how you're growing in your newfound faith. And now we hit chapter 4 and chapter 5, and he becomes very practical. And Paul then gives us kind of three marks of an authentic follower of Jesus. And so each week, we've been looking at one of these marks that Paul gives the people of Thessalonica and gives us as to what is an authentic follower of Jesus Christ. Do you remember what the first one is? Now, this is the second week I've asked you this same question, so hopefully you'll be able to figure this out. What is the first one? I heard it. Yeah, sexual purity. And so, good job. And so that was the first one he says. And so we thought that's kind of cool. It's the first characteristic of an authentic believer given to us in the very first letter of the Apostle Paul. This is the first instruction that should characterize every single authentic believer in Jesus Christ, that your life should be pursuing holiness. So we talked about that one 2 weeks ago. Then last week, you remember what that was? I already gave it to you, sorry. He says, you as a follower of Jesus need to have this healthy work ethic. If you ever say that the Bible isn't relevant for you today, then you have to be sleeping, because it talks about every single thing pretty much that you and I need to know and in order to have a successful life, and even talks about how you work, right? And so last week we talked about this aspect. You need to have a healthy work ethic and then live a quiet life. Live quietly, right? Remember Paul's words. He says, mind your own business. And we talked about what that means. And then today we come to this last one, this third authentic, third characteristic is you need to be future-minded. We need to live purposely. To live purposely, be future-minded. There was an uncertainty about the future that had become a pressing issue with the Thessalonians. The Thessalonians had a lot of questions about how things were going to pan out, and especially had questions about their fellow Christians who were dying. Many of their Christians, we believe, were being persecuted. Remember, this is why Paul had to flee, why Paul had to leave them. Paul was only there, we believe, about 3 weeks. He was only able to spend that much time with them, and because of his presence, they were experiencing persecution. And so Paul has to hightail it out of there for his own protection, but also for the protection of the people of Thessalonica. And so Paul now leaves, and he's in Corinth at this time, and he's writing back to them. remember kind of what happens in there. Paul's just kind of in agony as he's just hurting for these new Christians, wanting them to kind of grow in their newfound faith. And he doesn't know how they're doing. He can't pick up the phone and call them. And so he sends Timothy, his partner, back. And Timothy goes and kind of writes, records back to Paul what's happening. And then Paul writes this letter back to the church of Thessalonica. And that's what we're reading now. And he says, authentic followers of Jesus will have lives that pursue holiness, live quietly, and live purposely. It's pretty apparent as we study the context of the unfolding events of Thessalonica that there were some new Christians in this church that had died. Other aspects of even his second letter kind of help us to understand this, that so many people in their church, or some people within their church, were dying, and many theologians believe that they were dying again because they were being persecuted for their new faith. They were being murdered for their faith in Jesus. And so these Thessalonian believers were wrestling with some questions that I'm sure you and I would be wrestling with as well, and most of their questions all had to do with the future. Well, what about that person who died now and Jesus hasn't returned? Where do they go? What happens to them? And so Paul begins, and he's speaking into their life and encouraging them, and they had become troubled again with this issue of what happens to Christians when they die, but they most certainly believed in life after death because of all the other verses that we read. In fact, if you look back in the first chapter in the third verse, notice what Paul says. We remember before our God and Father, your work produced by faith. This is where we got the title for our series. Faith, your labor prompted by love, and your endurance inspired by hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. There's no question that Paul had told them about eternal life and the great hope that we have in Jesus Christ. He preached to them the gospel message, made that very clear to them. We saw how it was impacting their life, right? They were experiencing sanctification within their life. They were changing. Amazing things were happening. They were turning from idols to serve the living and true God. And so we know they knew about eternal life. They knew that salvation was synonymous with living forever with God in heaven. These were facts that they had been taught by Paul. They also knew about the coming of Jesus and his first advent. Paul had talked to them about that, and that Jesus was also going to return one day for his second advent, and that on that day he would gather all of his people together, and he would take them to be with him. And so it seems very apparent that Paul had taught them all these things, and now they're wrestling with just some of the specifics of that. Well, what about this, or what about that? And I think some of them were getting a little nervous, wondering to themselves, are those Christians who have previously died, what's going to happen? If they're not here, are they going to miss Christ's return? I like this. It's this interesting note. They loved each other so much that they didn't want each other to miss out on this beautiful reappearing of Jesus Christ. I think that's cool, right? So they hurt for their friends who had already passed because they didn't want their friends to miss out on Jesus' return. And so apparently they were feeling grieved as believers were dying for fear that they would miss this great event when there would be a gathering of God's people that would occur at the end of human history. And it was with their grief and their confusion that Paul intends to help clarify some of their questions and answer some of their questions for them. But to make matters worse, if you read ahead in Paul's second letter, we find this verse that tells us that they were also dealing with some false teachers. And so there were some false teachers who were kind of speaking into their lives, adding to their confusion, and then circulating a letter saying that this letter was actually from Paul, and it wasn't from Paul, and it was teaching them kind of a different teaching from what Paul's teaching was. And you say, well, how do you know that? Because Paul tells us. In fact, if you fast forward in the 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, this is Paul's second letter, this is what he says, concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered to him, that's what we're talking about today, we ask you, brothers and sisters, not to become easily unsettled or alarmed by the teaching allegedly from us, whether by a prophecy or by word of mouth or by letter, asserting that the day of the Lord has already come. So there were these false teachers who were speaking to these people saying, Jesus has already come. You can forget about that, right? And they were all confused, and so they're continuing to ask these questions and wondering what's going to happen to some of those who've already passed. And so Paul now is speaking into all of that, these things that are disturbing these new Christians. And consider their ongoing suffering and their persecution. Some of these young believers were convinced that they had missed the return of Christ and were now experiencing the day of the Lord's judgment. And so they were saying, because of all this persecution, we must be experiencing some tribulation right now. So maybe we did miss the coming of Jesus because now we're in this period of judgment that God is bringing upon us. And so this is kind of where their minds were. They were just confused. And despite their understanding of God's truth and their healthy spiritual growth that we see was happening, the church was shaken and very confused, and Paul begins to speak into their life with this comfort and with this peace. And I kind of feel like it's this fresh breath of air that these new Christians needed to hear. Paul will address their confusion in kind of two specific ways. Number one, he will remind them of the truth they already know. I love this. He's going to remind them of the truths that they already know, the firm foundation that they already have in Christ. Number two, he will further expand on those truths that he has previously introduced by applying them to their current confusion. So he's going to kind of bathe them in the truths, and then he's going to expand on those truths that he's already introduced them to by applying them to this current confusion that they're experiencing. So on one hand, he's going to point them back to the historical fact, back to the historical truth of the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And on the other hand, he's going to point them forward to the hope and the promise of the glorious return of Jesus Christ. So again, Paul's going to teach them to look back and be grateful for all that Jesus has done, and to look ahead and be hopeful for all that Jesus is going to do, that Jesus is still at work, that we can count on him, and we can trust what he says in his word is going to come true. And so he's saying we're going to look back, but we're also going to look ahead. And sensing their anxiety, Paul will seek to put an end to their doubts by unveiling one of the greatest promises of our Christian faith, and that is the return of Jesus Christ for his church. We sang about it, I think, in two of the songs this morning. 2 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 13, we now go to the beginning of this passage as Paul begins to help put some pieces together. Brothers and sisters, we do not want you to be uninformed about those who sleep in death, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. Maybe you have a different version that you're reading from, and this idea of sleep in antiquity was a very normal thing. Sleep is another way of saying they're dead, right? Those who sleep in death is the version that is the way that this version helps us to understand that. So don't get sidetracked by that. They weren't sleeping. They indeed were dead, right? And so that's what Paul is talking about. We do not want you to be uninformed about those who have died, is what he's saying, so that you do not grieve like the rest of mankind who have no hope. And so Paul begins addressing the Thessalonians in their confusion, and he says, we don't want you to be uninformed. We don't want you to grieve like everybody else who's lost loved ones who don't have the hope of the resurrection and the hope of Jesus Christ in their life. We're different, right? We're sons and daughters of the King. These promises are actually for us to tap into. And Paul clearly reveals that their grief and hopelessness was a direct result of their failure to understand death from God's perspective. And Paul says, I'm about to give you some knowledge. And this knowledge, this base, this firm foundation of truth is going to, as a result, is going to help you so you're not going to grieve like everyone else. And so he's going to give them some knowledge, and the purpose of giving them that knowledge is that so that they won't grieve like everyone else. I get a variety of questions as a pastor about faith on a regular basis, if that's through email, if that's through just personal questions or even text messages and things like that, and it's just one of the things that we as pastors do, and I don't always have the answers. In fact, many times I don't, because the answers that you ask are really good and really hard answers, and so sometimes it takes me time to kind of process those and kind of answer those questions, and at the same time, there are many moments in my life as a pastor where I'm able to sit next to the bedside of someone who's about to breathe their last breath, and I count that as a privilege, as I'm able to kind of sit with them and to kind of listen to them, listen to their questions and counsel them and hopefully offer them some comfort and some peace. And one of the things that I do in every single situation that I'm placed in, when I have these final words to say to this person as they're getting ready to take their final breath, is I always bring them back to the truth. I always bring them back to the core of who Jesus is and who they are in Christ, reminding them of the promises of that. And there's something about that that it just gives us this rock-solid foundation that encourages us, right? When we understand the truths, it helps us. And so it is vitally important that our theology, that our understanding of God, is what informs us in our most challenging life moments. And it should be our theology, it should be our understanding of God that helps us as we're searching for answers in our deepest moments of confusion and questions, right? And so often when people come up and ask me a question, I'll point them to another truth, because it's that truth that sometimes gives them the answer for what they're being faced with in that moment. And so Paul, the Apostle Paul, is doing the same thing. He's steering them back to the truth, going to direct them back to the gospel, direct them back to who Jesus is and what Jesus has done for them and the promises of the future hope of Jesus Christ. There's a commentary that I'm reading called Exalting Jesus in 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, and Mark Howell's the author, and he says this: theological ignorance invariably leads to confusion worthy and frustration. Meaning the less you know about truth, the less you know about your understanding of God, the more confused you're going to be. And it also means that the more that we engage in reading, the more that we understand God's truths and read his word on a regular basis, the more of a stronger foundation we're going to have is going to give us clarity for the questions we have in our life. And so he continues, he says, think of all the sleepless nights and restless days we can avoid if only we learn to view every circumstance through the lenses of God's word, right? And I share that because this is exactly what Paul's about to do. He's going to take them back to see their current situation through the lens of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. He's going to take them back to the truth, to the firm foundation of the truths of God's word. What a powerful statement that is. And just, I mean, think about that for just, think about something you're wrestling with right now and see that situation through the lens of God's word, through the truths of God's word. How would that change your current circumstance as you do that? And so we work through this text. We cannot miss Paul's point. And part of Paul's point is God's promises about tomorrow enable us to live a hopeful life for today. So his promises for tomorrow enable us to live a hopeful life today. Now, when we see this word hope in verse 13, in the Bible, this word hope doesn't mean wishful thinking. So I want to make sure we just kind of clarify that right out of the beginning. It's not like wishful thinking, like I hope this is going to happen and we can pray that this is going to happen. No, this hope is it's going to happen. It means a confident expectation that good is coming my way. That's what this hope means, a confident expectation that good is on the horizon. So we go back to this verse so we can kind of see this on the screen. I think it's important to know that Paul isn't telling us not to grieve. Paul's not saying not to grieve. He's saying so that you do not grieve like everyone else. So grieving is a part of the process of our hurt, right? When we lose a loved one, we grieve, and that's normal. Acts chapter 9 records one of the first believers who had passed away. Her name was Tabitha. Remember, she was a.k.a. Dorcas. I prefer her Aramaic name, which is Tabitha, right? And so we'll call her Tabitha. And so remember when Tabitha passed away and Peter was called to kind of visit the friends. And when he arrives, all the friends are crying. They're grieving over Tabitha's passing. And as they're grieving, remember, they're showing Peter all of the clothing that Tabitha had made. Picture Tabitha as this great seamstress or this girl who was able to crochet. And they're showing all of her art, creative artwork of clothes to Peter. And they're just weeping as they've lost one of their best friends. And they cried because they missed her. They had hope in a resurrection. Of course they did. But they missed her, and so they grieved. And it's okay to grieve. Jesus himself cried at Lazarus' own grave I mean, think about this, right? He was about to raise him from the dead, right? And Jesus wept. I mean, just moments before that, Jesus is weeping for Lazarus. And so he grieves for the loss of life. But more so, I think Jesus grieved because, biblically speaking, death is an enemy to life, right? Death is this enemy to life, but Jesus would soon defeat it when he would go to the cross on our behalf. So why do we have hope in the face of death? What makes us sure that death isn't the end? Paul's going to begin to answer that question now in verse 14. I want you to watch for it. So he's going to give us the answer. Why do we have hope in the face of death? What makes us so sure that death isn't the end? Paul's going to steer us back to the truth. So watch it. He's going to bring us back to the truth one more time, back through the lens of God's word. Notice what he says in the next verse. For we believe that Jesus died and rose again. Here's the truth. Right? Immediately he's going to the truth. So we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep. There's that word for death, for those who have died in him. So for we believe that Jesus died and rose again, and so we believe that God will bring with Jesus those who have fallen asleep in him. Why do we have confidence even in the face of death? Number one, we have confidence that is built on precedent. If you're taking notes, I don't have these on the screen. Number one, we have confidence that is built on precedent. Paul takes the Thessalonian Christians back to the fundamentals of their faith, which is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Our God beat death. Death did not have the final say because Jesus died and rose again. And Paul says, like Jesus died and rose again, we too believe that when we die, we will experience a rising again, right? We too will be given a brand new life one day for all eternity. And if Jesus beat death, then so will we. So their confidence was built on his precedent. He beat death, we'll beat death. That's how it works, and that's what Paul is saying. Christians have confidence in the future that's anchored in the past reality. Jesus beat death, and this is why we know that we too will beat death. Jesus lived beyond the grave, and that's why we believe that we too will live beyond the grave one day with him for all eternity. And the Thessalonians, again, needed to be reminded of this very truth that transformed their lives. Grief was this normal emotion as they thought about their loved ones who had passed, but to sorrow like those who did not have hope was to forget the very purpose for which Jesus came. Jesus came to give them hope. Jesus came to beat death. And Paul says, to sorrow like those who did not have hope was to forget the very purpose of which Jesus came. A powerful reminder for every generation. Have you ever noticed that the further we tend to get from the day that we surrendered our life to Christ? Think about that moment. I can remember mine vividly. When was the day that you surrendered your life to Christ and you would say that at that moment, that's when I became a Christian, a follower of Jesus? You remember that day? Isn't it interesting, like it seems like the further sometimes that we get away from that date, it seems like the less we tend to think about it. Until there comes a moment that we know we're closer to death. And then all of a sudden you start to think about it, right? Isn't it funny though how that happens? And I think Jesus knew that this would be kind of a normal response to us as human beings, is we're forgetful people. And so in a couple of weeks, we're going to remind ourselves of what Jesus did. And so on our Good Friday service, we're going to spend an entire evening together reminding ourselves of the truth of what Jesus Christ has done for us. Right? And so we'll celebrate that by doing communion. And Jesus says, you need to do this. Do this in remembrance of me. Do this in the remembrance of the truth of who you are in Christ and the truth that I defeated death. And because of that, you have a hope for the future, and a hope even currently. So what Paul is addressing here, we could call this kind of Christianity 101. It's pretty simple. He's talking about the death and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Notice what Paul says in another letter to the church of Corinth in chapter 15. If ever anyone ever asks you what the gospel is, and I've told you this before, I think a few weeks ago, but we've definitely got to bring it back. If ever anybody asks you what really is the gospel, and you want to take them to one clear passage, you write this down. This is the passage. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 through 8. And Paul, writing to the church of Corinth, is telling them what the gospel is. For what I received, I passed on to you as of first importance. Here it is, Christianity 101. That Christ died for our sins according to the scriptures, that he was buried. That means he died, right? You can't say that he died, he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas or Peter, and then to the 12. After that, he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers and sisters at the same time, most of whom are still living at the time he was penning this letter. Though some have fallen asleep, there's that idea again of death. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles, and last of all, he appeared to me also. Forward to verse 17, and if Christ has not been raised, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have no hope in Christ, we are of all people most to be pitied. Paul says this entire operation is based on the truth of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And if that didn't happen, then we're wasting our time today. And you can go home and get an extra hour of sleep. But we know that this is true. We know that that's why you're here. One of the greatest ways to know that it's true that the resurrection really happened is because the church of Jesus Christ is still alive. It's growing. It's thriving. People are still coming to a saving knowledge of Jesus, and lives are still being changed. And that's one of the greatest evidence of the proof that it actually happened because of what's taking place within the church even today as we speak. So here Paul is reminding us that this is true. Jesus, the Son of God, Jesus himself claiming to be God with skin, which is a crazy claim, right? And we believe that claim to be true, and then he beat death. And because he beat death, we believe it. It's actually true. And so we can take him seriously. And so Paul is anchoring them in the truths of God, and he doesn't want them to forget. So when the confusion, when the doubt, when the questions begin to surface in their heart and their mind, Paul says, wait a second, don't forget what he's done. Don't forget the hope that you have. Don't forget the guarantee of a new resurrection that we can experience as well. So how do we know that he won't leave us behind? Is just one of the questions that they were asking these believers. We're afraid he's going to leave us behind. How do we know that? And Paul moves on to answer that next question in verse 15 of chapter 4. According to the Lord's word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. According to the Lord's word, his very word, we tell you that we who are still alive, who are left until the coming of the Lord, will certainly not precede those who have fallen asleep. So Paul says, we have a word from the Lord. So number one, we have confidence that is built on the precedent of Jesus Christ and what he's already done. Based on that truth, the fact that he died and rose again, so he set the precedent for us, which we too are going to be able to experience that. Number two, we have confidence that is based on a promise. So confidence that is based on the precedent of Jesus, confidence that is based on the promise of Jesus, his very word. Our faith is backed up by fact. Our faith is backed up by truth. And so the promise is that he told us is that he would, and so we believe him. He says he's going to do this. We believe that he's going to do this. Anybody who can beat death, again, we should listen to what he's saying, not just wishful thinking, but this is a firm foundation of truth. And Paul is imploring the Thessalonians to look back at what they know and look forward to the truth and the hope of what's to come. So if this is all according to the Lord's word, as it says here in this verse, then when and where did Jesus tell us that this would happen? If Paul says it's according to the Lord's very word, then where can we see some of this actually happening? Well, there's several places, and here's one place where Jesus himself said it as he's talking about kind of these end times in Matthew 24. He says, immediately after the distress of those days, the sun will be darkened, the moon will not give its light, the stars will fall from the sky, and the heavenly bodies will be shaken. The earth will be shaken. Then will appear the sign of the Son of Man in heaven. And then all the peoples of the earth will mourn when they see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of heaven. We sang about this just a few moments ago. With the power and great glory. And he will send his angels with a loud trumpet call. Similar language to what Paul's using here. And when they gather his elect from the four winds, from one end of the heaven or the four corners of the earth, some people say, from one end of the heavens to the other. So Jesus arose, and he also said he is coming back. And our confidence in all of this is built on the precedence, and it's built on Jesus' promise. He said he was going to do it. We trust that he's going to do it. Number three, he will not tell us, he will now tell us that he would see to it personally. And so we can also have confidence because he's going to tell us that he's going to see to it personally. He's going to put a stamp on it. He's going to guarantee it. And notice what he says in the next verse. For the Lord himself will come down from heaven. Here's that language again that we just see. With a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. So those who have already died, who were believers, who were Christians, followers of Jesus, those who've already died and been buried will rise first. So think about all those who've passed before us, right? They're going to go first. A bit of a benefit, I guess, right? After that, we who are still alive, the rest of us who are still left on the earth when Jesus returns, we will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words. Why do we believe that we have hope beyond the grave? Because we have a precedent that he beat death. We have a promise that he said that he would give us. And he's going to see to it personally that he's going to make it happen. He's not sending an emissary. He's not sending a representative. But he's coming himself. Not sending somebody else. He's coming himself. He's coming in the clouds for us. Now, this section of this passage of Scripture and probably this entire book and probably out of the whole Bible, this is one of those most debated verses that many people like to discuss and try to figure out. The focus is centered on Paul's reference to those who are still alive and are left, it will be caught up together with them in the clouds. The word that's used here for this idea of caught up is where we get the word that we use in our English version of rapture. And so you've heard of rapture lingo and rapture language, and this is where that word comes from. It's the Latin translation of the Greek word that Paul is using to describe the church being caught up together in the clouds. The word means to seize or to snatch away. It implies a sudden or kind of a violent event that's happening. And we must not miss the unmistakable fact that the promise of Jesus' sudden return for his church, it's presented to us right here in this very passage. Jesus is coming back. Now, there are a variety of interpretations as to the timing of the rapture. That's where a lot of people try to debate and have these discussions of where is the timing of the rapture going to happen. And these Christians in the church of Thessalonica were also wrestling with this themselves. Well, what's going to happen when they die and then Jesus returns? Or what's going to happen to the rest of us who are left and then Jesus returns? And what's going to happen if you're caught kind of in the middle? You know, are you going to miss out on all of the glory and wonder of what's about to happen? Here's what almost all Christians believe in and agree on these few things. There will be a tribulation period that we will experience one day. The Bible is clear on that. There will be a rapture where we will be caught up together in the air. This is one of those passages where the Bible is very clear on that. And just like Paul says here in this passage, the debate again is the timing. It's the timing of when these events are going to happen. Will the church, where you and I, be raptured before the tribulation period? Or will the church be raptured after the tribulation period? Meaning, will we have to be here during the tribulation, right? And that's just two versions. There are more, right? So those are just two of the versions. Many of you have landed on some of those versions, and I trust that you're continuing to study that because it'll mess with your brain. But I hope that we will be raptured before the tribulation. I hope that we're right on that. Listen to one commentator reflect on this passage. He says, this passage portrays one of the most significant events in the history of God's church, the day when Jesus gathers his church to be with him. Regardless of where commentators land in their various interpretations of this text, the hope and comfort offered by it must not be missed. If the element of encouragement is in any way removed, the entire text loses its meaning. There is no element of encouragement in this passage if the promise of the rapture is not central. So this is the message. This is what we're learning. This is what Paul's talking about. And we have to know that this is the promise and this is the central message of what Paul's bringing us back to helping us understand. So there may be debate about, you know, among theologians as to the timing of these events, that Christ, when those things will happen, but it is certain that Christ will return. He will come, he will rule, and he will be glorified. Without question, the Bible teaches that Jesus is coming again. It is all over the pages of Scripture. I found some interesting stats on this. Did you know that 23 of the 27 books in the New Testament state that Jesus is coming? I didn't know these stats. 23 of 27 books in the New Testament state that Jesus is returning. Did you know that one out of every 30 verses in the New Testament either speaks directly of his coming, of the end times surrounding his coming? So it's either speaking directly of his coming or the end times surrounding his coming. That's a lot of language about the last, about his returning, one out of 30 verses. For every biblical reference to Jesus' first coming, there are 8 that point to his return. That's crazy. Clearly, the Bible's authors do not want us to miss this truth. Clearly, God himself does not want you to miss this truth, as each of those authors, right, were carried along by the Holy Spirit as they penned this very book that we read. So the Bible doesn't want us to miss it. God doesn't want us to miss it. It was never intended to be speculation, but rather it was to be a reason for anticipation and motivation and great hope. And here's what I know. When people ask me, I tell them all I know is we are one day closer. We are one day closer. It could be today. It could be tomorrow. It could be 3,308, I think, is when I'm meeting with the Apostle Paul for lunch. I don't know. In fact, the Bible tells us that no one knows the time except the Father. And so we like to read passages in Revelation and Daniel and try to put some of those pieces together, and that's okay. We can certainly have fun with that and try to broaden and strengthen our theology on these things, but just know, we don't really know. Only the Father knows. This week, Thursday afternoon, I had the privilege of visiting our Golf U family friend, Sandra Custer. Sandra's had quite a bout with her health. Received the news about 2 months ago or so that she was diagnosed with cancer. She was in the hospital trying to just figure some things out, and they did a surgery, and the surgery was successful for a few moments, and then it seemed like within days she was right back to where she was, and they were debating about doing another surgery and going through all of this difficult process of beating cancer that was kind of beginning to spread, and she was just kind of fighting all of this. And Sandra just came to a moment where she says, you know what, I don't really want to pursue all of these surgeries again because this one really wasn't working, and this is kind of how I'm processing what's happening within her brain, and I don't really want to continue down that path, because this is right now what God has handed me as I'm battling this cancer. And so Sandra began to be overwhelmed with a peace in her life. And she said, I just trust that if this God's timing, that God's just going to take me home. And Sandra began to have this unusual peace about seeing Jesus that I don't always see. And so I sat with her Thursday and kind of just talked with her and shared some scripture, and our friend Cindy was there as well, and we just kind of was comforting her, and we were laughing and talking about some fun stories that we had as well. And there in the hospice room, we were just, you know, sharing and praying together. And one of the passages that I told her, I said, would you believe it that the very passage that I'm reading Sunday is this passage? And I quoted, and I said, Sandra, it tells us that we as followers of Christ, that we don't have to grieve like the rest of the world grieves. So whenever Jesus calls you home, we are going to miss you. And yes, we're going to grieve, but we don't grieve like the rest of the world grieves who doesn't have hope. We grieve. We miss her presence now, but we know she's in the presence of the Lord. And so we were kind of sharing that some of those verses with her and several others. And then I prayed with her and I said, Sandra, before I left, I said, Sandra, I promise you that I will see you again. I promise you. About 8 hours later, Sandra went home to be with Jesus. And we hear that news and we grieve. But we don't grieve like everybody else in the world grieves who has no hope. Because we know where Sandra is today. We have great hope that one day, for those of us who love and know Jesus, that one day we will see her again. And it's because, not just wishful thinking, it's because of the truths of God's word that Paul's drawing us back to. He's pulling us back to see these circumstances through the lenses of God's word, of God's truth. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for your word that counsels us, your word at times that rebukes us, at times how it corrects us, and your word how it encourages us and comforts us. And as we read Paul's response to this new young fledgling church in Thessalonica, it encourages us. His goal was to comfort them and to encourage them and to bring them back to the truths of the foundation of who we are in Christ and the foundation of our Christian faith, and that is the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And as he's drawing us back to that, he's reminding us that as our Lord and Savior beat death, so we too will beat death. We will be raised to a new life, and we will live with you one day for all eternity. That one day when you return to snatch us up, to gather us up, that we will be reunited with our bodies for those of us who passed before you come. And to think about those awesome privileges and those awesome truths about all that you're doing as we anticipate the future should encourage us. So God, strengthen our theology, strengthen our truths, so that we have hope for the future. Father, I pray for our church this morning as we're grieving the loss of our sister. But we don't grieve like the rest of the world grieves, because we have hope. And Lord, for those of us who know and love you, we know because of the promises of your word that we will see her one day again. God, we thank you for a future hope that you give us, that you promise us. In Jesus' holy name we pray, amen. I want to say thank you this morning for worshiping with us. We're trying to figure out and talk to the family to figure out what some of those next steps are and when a service will happen, but we'll make sure that we keep you up to date with that. Thank you so much.